Welcome to CACE International. I'm Fakisha Kumbo.
And I'm Michelle Flores.
This is our second part of Women in Jazz with Jerry Allen, Abby Lincoln, Bobby Humphrey, Renatia Adams, and Lisa Terry. We're back with our part two with these lovely ladies. Jerry Allen, pianist extraordinaire, virtuoso on her instrument, ethnomusicologist. Abby Lincoln, legend in our time, song stylist, arranger, musical director. She writes music. Bobby Humphrey, first lady of the flute. She's her own boss, entrepreneur, on Warner Brothers label now. Lisa Terry, violinist, changed from classical music, now in jazz, plays with Max Roach's double quartet. She's also part of Uptown Quartet, right? And Renatia Adams, about to embark on a trip to the Soviet Union, song stylist, and all of our ladies write music. We left off. I was asking about what direction is music going? Bobby was talking.
Well, it's hard to say. Music is never going in just one direction. It's always been a coexistence of different types of style, different directions of music. I plan to start on my next album, which will be my 20th anniversary album. So it's going to be a combination of different types of music.
You've been recording for 20 years?
In 1991 it will be.
Wow.
I was the first female signed to Blue Note Records in 1971.
Are they reviving that Blue Note label at all?
It's been revived, yeah. It's being distributed by Capitol. Yes, there are. I believe Diane Reeves, she records for Blue Note. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Abby, please tell us some memories of the wonderful Lady Day.
I met her in Honolulu in 1954, about. She was very beautiful. She came to see me a couple of times. I worked at the Trade Winds, about 3 or 4 blocks from where she was. And she sat at the bar with her Mexican Chihuahua, and she checked me out. She never said anything to me, and I was in awe of her. I was afraid to approach her. So I'd finished my show, and I'd run to the Brown Derby to see her. Well, I think Billy was one of the most beautiful women who ever lived, physically and spiritually. She was a queen without her court and without her horses and her chariots. And she left a lot for the singers who came after her. You know, a great one.
Yeah, she was wonderful. We touched a little bit on sexism in jazz and music. Jerry, I believe you have some comment you want to make on that.
Well, I just wanted to say that it's because of people like Abby Lincoln and people like Mary Lou Williams, who was a great pianist, composer, band leader, orchestrator, people like Lovie Austin, who was one of the first women to have her own band and to take her band on the road. And she wrote music for Bessie Smith and for Ida Cox and Ma Rainey. And because of Billie Holiday, who you just spoke of so eloquently, and all of these great women who have set the stage for us to be able to do what we're doing, and they have made it possible and much, much easier for for the young musicians who've come along afterwards.
Renatia, what type of respect do you get as, are you in the shadow sometimes because your husband is a well-known musician? Do you find that you're sometimes in the shadows? Do you get the respect that you think you deserve?
A lot of times when people meet me, they ask me, am I Clifford Adams' wife? And yes, I do feel like I'm in the shadows a lot. But when I'm performing, I am, you know, the queen, I am me. And there's nothing that, you know, he can take away from me because I'm not in the shadows any longer. Earlier, Abby Lincoln and I were talking, and she touched on the female, the singer is always in front.
Hey.
And it's always in front of the band. And when Abby Lincoln speaks, it's like, you listen.
That's right.
And so sometimes I do feel like I'm in the shadows, but when I'm singing, yes, I am in front.
You're up front.
Yes.
Lisa, working with Black and Blue, you're the only female in a male-dominated band. What's it like? I mean, how do you get what you deserve? Do you get the proper...
Well, I'm glad you asked me that, because I wanted to address that issue. It's an incredibly wonderful experience for me. It could be nothing more than that. I have 12 of the most supportive musicians with me on that bandstand that stand behind me in everything I play and everything I do. I could get up there some nights and totally botch it up. And they'll come up to me and say, yeah, babe, you were great tonight. I loved it. You know, you got me out. It was great. You know, I heard you over there scratching on that thing.
Yeah.
And it's the constant support and reassurance that they give me. And I've never been in a musical situation, and I've played in many classically, where I've received that kind of support and that kind of camaraderie.
Yeah.
So once they accept you and they know that you're trying and you're working at it and you keep striving, they're behind you the whole way, you know?
Yeah.
And, I've never felt odd because I was the only woman. I felt special.
Mm.
I felt not only because I'm a woman, but also because of my instrument,
you know?
And I feel special. And it's, I say I have the best job on Broadway for a violinist.
Great.
What Abby Lincoln, too, was saying about there being men being dominating the music out of sheer numbers, too, and historically. I have to say, too, that coming up, there was a man, and is a man, Marcus Belgrave from Detroit, who sort of took a lot of us under his wing. I was one, people like Kenny Garrett and Bob Hurst and people like that who are out here doing very well now, all sort of came up under that, where the musicians grab hold to the younger musicians and say, come along, I want to show you the way, you know, a way to go. And I have to say that coming up, I never really experienced any negativity, and I always was pushed in the same way that you're saying, you know, there was always a positiveness about, you know, if you want this, just go for it, and certainly you're going to have to work for it. And,
sure
and you'll be doing it for the rest of your life, but if you want it, there it is.
It probably has a lot to do with your being successful, too. You know, all of you being successful.
Yes, the men gather behind the women, and if she's, I mean, they expect her to be serious, but they love the music more than anything.
That's right. Yeah, so if you got the music, then there's no problem.
Hey!
Yeah. Bobby, I know you're your own boss and entrepreneur. You have a production company?
Yes, we.
What I want to ask you is, how important is your family unit in allowing you to get your work done that's not like in the home? In other words, the work you have to do.
Mm-hmm. I think that a strong family unit is important to any person in business or in entertainment or any type of field, not regardless of whether that leader is a male or a female. If you're happy in your home life, it makes a easier arena for you to create and to go out into the quote-unquote marketplace and to sell your goods. It's very important of having that balance at home.
Can we look forward to a Women in Jazz organization getting started? Is there a need to do something like
we
that?
We don't even have a men in jazz organization.
Well, there have been some.
No, we haven't. We don't have a union. The music, in a way, is like an orphan in the street. It's a great form, but it is not subsidized. It is not. We have no patrons for the music. Mm-hmm. And we're at the mercy of anybody who decides that they like the music. We don't have any organizations like that. So maybe the women and the men could come together and make something to make it make it easier and a better way for the youngsters who are coming.
Yeah, because Randy Weston, whose tune we're going to hear when we take the break. We're just about up for time for our CACE gallery break. But they had something about the Afro-American Society years and years ago. They tried to get organized around accomplishing stuff. We got a break right now for CACE Gallery. And our visual artist, whose earrings I'm wearing, is Siwala, a Liberian. Liberian jewelry designer. You've seen her work in the pages of Essence magazine. And while we watch her work, we're going to listen to Miss Abby Lincoln doing Fly from her latest album on Verve Polygram called
The World Is Falling Down.
With
Clark Terry.
Yes.
And Jackie McLean.
And Jackie McLean.
Yes.
And Smiling Billy Higgins.
Yes.
And this tune, by the way, is written by my good friend Randy Reston. And John Hendricks wrote the lyrics. Mm-hmm. Listen up. You'll enjoy this. Be right back.
People walking around, living in a daze, high up above the ground, with their snooty ways, putting people down, acting phony while they fly high, with their fancy clothes and their corny jokes, looking down their nose at the common folk they can never see. Life the way it ought to be. Always seem to have passed us by. These days, life is in high fly. Everybody's here. Every kind of sound comes from everybody's down, about to really flip, acting phony while they fly high.
Question I want to ask you ladies, what was the motivating force behind you getting involved in this business of music?
I, from a very early age, was surrounded by music, all types of music, and if I would have to single out any one person in terms of who really inspired me that the dream that I held could really be a reality, I would have to say my band director in high school. He took a couple of kids aside and said, I'm going to teach you jazz. And it was that one particular teacher who made a difference of planting the seed, I would say, my band director, Allison Tucker.
Mm-hmm. I went for solitude. I'm one of 12 children, the 10th child. All of us living in this house that my father built for us. And there was a piano. And I experimented with the piano when I was a child, like 5 years of age. And my relatives didn't drag me and say, Anna Marie, get off the piano, you're getting on my nerves. Mm-hmm. And I had a chance to discover the magic of finding something more than once, you know, a sound. Mm-hmm. And
that was a spark.
Yes, it was friendship and for myself, just all by myself. Space for myself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.